Hello, listeners.
Hello, viewers.
This week, we're drowning out Prostitute Murderer Simulator 2.
A Yahtzee creation.
Actually, it's...
It's an emergent gameplay thing that Yahtzee developed in Euro Truck Simulator 2.
Thank you, yes, it's Euro Truck Simulator 2. Now, I must confess, I only downloaded this game for the purpose of this thing, but while I was testing it, I got really into it.
You'll notice up in the top right corner there, Master, level 20, driven distance, 32,000 kilometers. Actually, first my question is, do they have a file of pictures of truckers that you can use for your icon?
They certainly do.
That's fantastic.
I think they might be the developers, though.
I wonder
about that one, though.
I was resistant to all of these, because this whole series, anything with, like, simulator at the end, just feels like it's deliberately baiting a series like this. Like, I didn't want to do it purely for that. And then you went and got it, and now I have an answer to my question, what sort of lonely weirdo plays these things?
Well, let me sell you on it, man. Because
I think
I was in the middle of a drive when I last played this. Oh, yeah, it just stops me in the middle of the road. Thank you, road safety. Are you convinced yet?
Desert bus 2015.
No, but really, there's actually scenery in this. Look at those nice Japanese pagodas in the background there.
Yeah. Well, this great. Is... I thought you were going to crash.
Now, this is a toll booth. It means I have to pay them a little bit of money when I get to the end of this road.
We got a great big Yahtzee trucking through the night.
Now, I respect the field of extremely realistic simulator, something I've sometimes referred to as the dad game. Oh, bollocks!
What did you do?
That was not my fault, whoever it was. Fucking road hogs!
What the fuck kind of neck have you got? You're swerving all over the road, you maniac.
Well, someone bumped into me and I got fined for that. I ain't taking that shit. I'm Trucker McGee. But yes, I have some respect for this sort of thing, because...
I do up until they start costing like $5,000 for all the DLC.
Well, the thing is, it's occupying a niche.
Yeah.
And if you're trying to make money from games, this sort of thing can be a very good option. Because if you want to make money, you either sell 1,000 copies at $20 each, or you sell 20 copies at $1,000 each.
Yeah, I know, I know.
And if there are people who'll buy that, then that's all you need. And it turns out there are. Dads.
I am... sort of interested just objectively in these kind of weird little niche groups. Like, I had a friend that used to play, like, loads of Jagged Alliance 2. Mm. And he'd play that online, and the only people you ever play online are people who speak German and really like communism.
Right.
It's weird. So, like, just all East German lunatics sitting playing Jagged Alliance 2. And Jagged Alliance 2 is an insane game for insane people. Like, you can't have a mercenary team with, like, a Turk and an Albanian on it, because they'll hate each other, and that will mean they won't work as well. Like, that's the micromanaging level you've got to deal with.
I think Big Boss would have words with that idea.
Big Boss.
He created a brotherhood of mercenaries without countries or borders. They were all very happy. They had pizza parties every week.
Big Boss hosts the best pizza parties. Only half the pizza ever gets made, but still.
But then the niche audience that plays Euro Truck Simulator 2 is not the same kind of niche audience that plays Jagged Alliance.
No, but it's an example of the kind of...
We were discussing this sort of thing a while back, and I remember you expressing disbelief that there might be a niche of retired truck drivers that plays this sort of thing.
I thought it would be a little bit weird. Like, if there was a game about bouncing, I don't think I'd play it exactly. Although I will say the best sim of that was in
bouncing meaning
Fallout.
Ejecting people from bars. Because I'm sure people are now imagining your fat bum jiggling up and down as you hop down a staircase.
Yes, that was something I got paid to do. Just a very wealthy industrialist used to pay me to jump up and down in front of them. It was fully clothed, too, which is what was the confusing part to me.
It was like Mr. Burns.
Yeah.
Yes.
His last name was not Reinhardt.
But my dad was a train engineer, and after he retired, he spent a lot of time with his train set. It's the same sort of principle. And the people who demand absolute realism from these games are the ones who are buying all this $1,000 DLC to increase the illusion that they're back on the road and in their glory days.
See, to me, engineering has an element of creativity. Like, a train set is a creative endeavor, whereas this is a maze that you are running through like a rat.
Well, the end result is equally as pointless.
Well, everything's pointless, but I'm a bit perplexed about how someone who did this for a living, because I've known truckers who don't seem like, and I've never met one who seems to enjoy their job. I'm not saying it's impossible that they do, but I just find it a bit odd that doing something that is long, grueling, takes you away from your family, is then something you'd want to do in a weird simulation sense like this. Like, I'm not saying it's impossible, I just find it really weird.
And yet here I am.
Well, yeah, but you've never driven a truck, so this is novel for you.
But I kind of feel like I want to now.
I'm going to buy you some flannel.
I reckon I could really enjoy a job on the open
Wait,
road.
Wait, do Euro truckers wear flannel, or is it...
Possibly.
Is it more maybe of a decorative cravat?
I think they wear black and white striped shirts with strings of onions around their necks going ho-he-ho.
But well, they man the baguette cannon.
But I'm actually a Brit trucker on the continent, as you can tell from my right-hand drive in my truck. That's something you have to remember when you take your payload to England or the continent, the different sides of the road you drive on. But
weird, just the idea of like a truck that can drive between countries to me, because Australia, that just doesn't happen.
We're currently having a lovely drive in the French countryside.
All right, I'm not...
So it's interesting now that you know it's on the continent, isn't it? All these lovely French fields.
See, it's how accurate is the landscape?
Not very at all.
Oh, well, fuck that.
I mean, I think Paris is a bit bigger than that.
See, that's bullshit. If it was, almost picture accurate, I could really get into this, because then it's I can drive around and see shit.
Well, I guess when you're driving for about an hour, or when you're driving for about 8 hours, that's pretty much the same. So it is a...
Is it in real time?
No, it is a rather shrunk down world map.
Oh, okay.
And if you... It's the standard sim sort of 1 minute per second thing. Actually, the other thing in this game is that you run a little truck driving company.
Your own miserable business.
So I've got two garages in London, Birmingham, and these are the NPC drivers I've got working for me.
They all look dead inside. They couldn't... Yeah. That woman looks... Oh, God.
I think that might just be a dude who murdered a prostitute and wore her face.
Hello, I am Irina. Pretty. Yes. So pretty.
I've had the change.
Goodbye,
but back
horse.
On the French countryside, isn't it a lovely day for a drive? I mean, you said, you can't imagine why truck drivers want to be away from their family, but you know what I'm like with my family.
Yeah, but it's a tough thing to understand, and I feel the same way, but there are people who actually enjoy time with their family.
I mean, it's nice to see all the scenery. If you go to Dover here, you can see all the white cliffs and shit.
Well, see, that's, again, if... All the landscape was, zone accurate, and you could see, actual things that were on these roads that may be of interest, then that would be something that would entertain me, because I'd be oh, look, stuff.
Well, there is a fair bit of that.
Oh, cool.
But you have to understand, the truck highways of the continent aren't designed for the scenic route.
No. Well, I know, I accept that. I'm more concerned, is it just stretch after stretch of completely unrelated, just lumps of, landscape that they haven't put any effort into?
Generally.
What happens when you get to somewhere you're not meant to go? Or is there no, it just circles around the road, just doesn't exist?
It just puts a big barrier up across the road. So in most towns, you can see, famous buildings in the distance, but you can't actually get onto the road.
They're not for you, you lower class lump. Get back to your labouring.
Well, yeah, man, we got shit needs to get to places.
The lifeblood of industry. What happens if you just drive through that? Because already I just want to just run
you
into things
can't.
And wreck shit. Really?
I'm not playing messy with this game. I got a driver rating of 5 to think about. What am I carrying, actually?
Forklifts.
Forklifts, yes. Yep, those are forklifts. I love that. I love the sort of dog on a car ride move. hey look, Patches, it's a cat.
So you can't crash the truck or do anything remotely interesting?
Well, you can crash the truck, but then you can just get towed back to a town and get it repaired. Just stops working.
Can you fillet through a glory hole on a truck stop?
You don't get spectacular crashes or anything. Yeah. Well, you do rest at truck stops, and then the screen just fades out, and I guess you just sort of have to use your imagination.
I'd say the flating's implied there,
Go to
really.
Truck stop, fillet someone, murder prostitute, back on the road.
Don't murder prostitutes. It's a shame that we have to say it, really. Sick of this,
I'm just picturing, some kind of prostitute murderer listening to this now.
Oh, yeah.
And that's the first time anyone's ever stood up to him.
Anyone ever fucking thought to say it? That's the problem, you know, we just don't think to say it.
That's such a radical, exciting idea. I'm thrilled by the prospects. Maybe I won't murder a prostitute. Yeah. Maybe I don't have to be a slave to the voices. Yes, you do. Shut up.
We're the voices. We're much more interesting voices. Listen to us.
Yes, we're the voices. Listen to every single voice in your head and do exactly what they tell you to do. Things can only improve.
Errant thoughts.
You will probably go to heaven.
Not just any heaven. First class VIP heaven.
Oh hey, driver Stephanie just brought me 1,258 euros. Stephanie was the penultimate person I hired. She's really come into her own as a driver.
This sure makes a change for her from blowing Russian mafioso on shitty webcams.
Hey, I only hire respectable female truckers, the ones that are secretly men.
That's what helps them truck so good.
So anyway...
See, I don't know. See, this is why I find this whole genre of game like just bait for videos, you know what I mean? It's like, hey, look, it's not possibly fun. Isn't that zany?
Yeah, I can understand that.
So I outright refuse to do these things.
But there is actually a big niche for the simulator genre. I mean, there used to be a studio in Brisbane, Oran, who made train simulators. And that was the core
of when Brisbane had a video game industry?
Well, it still does.
Really?
It's just all small developers that
made up... it's just half-brick now.
Rose from the ashes of the failed big developers now.
Well, one person who I was talking to was grumbling that one of the big things was all the studios took on, like, just busy work. Loads and loads of busy work. Doing, like, ports of shit and not making their own IP. Well, so when it stopped being cheap to do ports here, boing, bye industry.
Well, Pandemic Brisbane's, what brought them down is that they took on the Dark Knight game. But they didn't put any of their top talent onto it. They just sort of hired a whole bunch of new guys, and I'm simplifying, obviously. But kind of the nail went in the coffin the moment no game arose for the Dark Knight.
Yeah, because it just went straight to, Arkham... whatever. Asylum.
I mean, the film, The Dark Knight.
Yeah, well, because there was a Batman Begins game that was kind of all right. It had, like, you had to scare the guys a bit.
Okay. I haven't played it. I've heard it was bad.
It's not great, but it actually used the idea that Batman's meant to strike fear into the enemies as a mechanic, which I can't think of any other Batman game has really done that, so...
Arkham Asylum kind of does that.
Yeah.
Enemies get more scared, the more of them you pick off, they start acting erratically.
If anything, that makes it harder, though, because they look around more.
Eventually they panic and go, screw this, I'm going off alone, and that's when you strike.
Descend on them like some kind of winged mammal.
You're basically the horror movie monster at that point. I always wanted a game where you are the horror movie monster. I mean, I remember writing up a treatment for something like where you play as, you know, Michael Myers from Halloween or Jason Voorhees. And your task is to get points for killing people with the absolute perfect timing and appropriateness for the situation.
And that would be, the cinematic quality of the kill,
it would be like
which I'm sure won't agitate parents' groups.
It would have been like Hitman. There'd be like this self-contained level with all these characters doing their own shit. And you just have to seize opportunities.
Would you have a bonus for, like, environmental kills where you scare the woman into running and she slips on something and, like, falls into a pool with, like,
a
toaster in her hands and then there's electricity?
Then you get, like, a super combo.
Super combo. Although a little bit like Manhunter. So
I am
elements
sort
of
describing Naughty Bear there, and that was awful.
Well, a shitty execution of an idea doesn't negate the idea. I always feel like I need to point that out.
Well, no. It might in the eyes of investors, but they're shitheads.
Fucking investors.
Well,
look, a city.
Yes. Let's see which one it is, actually.
Deutschland. It's the city of Deutsch.
It's Gay Paris.
Oh, is it?
Yes. Not going to see no Eiffel Towers, I don't think. We're heading to Lyon.
Let's drive to Australia.
Can't.
Damn it.
The nearest is Verona.
You've got, like, one mosquito in here, and it's driving me insane.
Well, just let him have a snack, and maybe he'll leave.
I'm gonna uppercut it. I once punched a fly so hard it hit the wall and splattered, and that was fun.
Well, I was talking about Auron a while
back. Made me feel like Goku.
Auron made train simulators, and that was basically the backbone of their income. Because they just had, like, a small, extremely niche audience who they just kept bringing out more and more train packs.
I suppose it'd be a dedicated audience too, like a reliable...
Well, it was sort of a double-edged sword, because, yeah, they were dedicated, and they'd buy all your packs, but they'd also complain about the slightest inaccuracies with relation to the real-life trains.
Goes with the territory, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, there's a whole bunch of real-life truck dealers in this game. I don't know how authentic it is.
I mean, once you get, you know, it's a bit like Street Fighter. Like, every time there's a slight change, at least half the fan base will go batshit.
You can customize your truck in this game, but you can only swap out, you know, really boring... bullbar-looking things for...
Other boring bullbar-looking things.
Yes, probably all authentic bullbars that you can buy.
Going a bit quick there, Yarts.
Don't worry, I have a brake key for
what
this.
What kind of maniac are you? I feel like you should absolutely get a steering wheel for this, dude. You're doing it on a keyboard that's
the keyboard does really make steering a lot wonkier. But I'm not going to buy a steering wheel just for this.
Frankly. This game needs a fuckload of Easter eggs.
Just going to check my wing mirror. Yep, looks good.
You find like a car broken down, you pull over and a T-1000 kills you and takes off in your truck.
But then Auron tried to make a fantasy RPG called Fury, and it basically totaled their company because nobody bought it.
That's a shame.
Yeah.
Was it any good?
I don't know, I never played it.
Case in point.
Exactly.
I mean, it's kind of sad. Like, I could feel... I mean, if you were a developer,
yeah, I mean,
wouldn't you
want to
get away from just doing... I don't know, like, are you happy just making train sims? Like,
well, that's the thought, isn't it? You say, I'm just going to make the train sims for a while.
And then, yeah,
and then I'll make the interesting things that interest me.
Because, I mean, fundamentally, there is an element of creative expression to these goddamn things. And doing train sims over and over and over and over and over again will probably do your fucking head in.
Well, of course, the other thing that can take down a company is having a two-auteur developer in charge who just wants to make, you know, his own creative IP that no one will... No one wants to tell him was absolute garbage. Yes, thank you. Thank you, strange gospel choir in the background. Where's Gabriel gone?
I'm so glad you hired those guys. It's made our little get-together so much more fun. Why do they have to wear collars?
Yes, they sort of sing along to when the Roomba's going around.
Yahtzee bought a Roomba.
Yeah, that was one of my ideas for topics, because there's fuck all else.
Well, yeah, the fact that there's fuck all else will be one of the topics. But yeah, Yahtzee bought a Roomba, and he's always wanted a dog. Like, Yahtzee loves fucking puppies. If you ever want a positive reaction from him, just bring him a puppy.
I love dogs. I don't love them quite enough to want to not live in an apartment.
Yeah, and the thing is, he lives in an apartment, so he can't have a dog. So instead, he has a Roomba, and what did you call the Roomba, Yahtzee?
Sodbury. I like that, because it's also a good name for a butler. Now clean the place, Sodbury, and by the time I get back, if you've been very good, I'll put you back on the charger.
How much was that, just out of curiosity?
$600.
Fuck that!
Well, I figured to myself, you know, I hate cleaning. The place needs vacuuming. It's a one-level, small apartment.
You know what's funny?
I'm a bachelor with disposable income.
I take one look left, and I see just a bunch of dust and shit on the floor, and it's like, what is the Roomba doing?
Well, it's had trouble navigating the table. It's got some wonky legs. But the rest of the floor is spick and span. I might just sweep under there when I can be asked.
This is the problem with every little automatic doodad, is it always misses bits.
Oh, I think my character just yawned.
Revolutionary.
That means I need to take a rest somewhere.
Ah.
But we've got 19 hours till the drop, so plenty of time for a rest. And 5 hours to the destination. There's plenty. I think that's a comfortable window for a little sleepy. The next
like
rest stop.
Prostitutes.
Yeah.
See, prostitute murder is at least one of the reasons why you should have legal brothels. Like, I don't...
Well, yes. Besides all the lovely sex.
Yeah, well, it makes it... And, you know, it's... Should be allowed to sell fucking sex. I don't get the... puritanical bastards.
Yes, I mean, well, it's the oldest profession, isn't it?
Yeah.
Besides hunting stroke gathering.
It's actually funny. There have been experiments done of introducing the concept of money to Capuchins.
And I've heard that,
within
yes.
about... I watched the fucking video of it, and within like, minutes, they'd figured out prostitution. Like, minutes. And theft. Yes. And also, like, con jobs. Like, tricking other monkeys into thinking that they were giving them good food for, like, coins, and then they didn't.
And they left it overnight, came back, and one of the monkey was wearing a suit and sitting behind a little desk and smoking a cigar.
Probably wondering why I called you in here today.
And, like, complaining to the other monkeys that... They were just lazy and shiftless when they were doing all his work for him.
He was the most important monkey, the one that innovated.
Yes.
With his new railway medal.
He was the ook percent. Well, we did a quick look at, I think it was IGN's rundown of the top five gaming news
stories.
We
looked at a variety, because part of what I think the problem was is we'd sort of just look at different news sources and then we'd come here and we'd have half forgotten. So I thought, well, here's a fun idea. We'll both sit down before we do the video and we'll have a look at some news and see what we can drum up. And we both had already had a bit of a look and come to the conclusion that it was just going to be a bunch of clickbaity opinion articles or shitty roundups or just whatever leftover crap that every website trots out when there's nothing to talk about.
You know, one of the first headlines we saw was Fox not making Deadpool film. Now there's news.
Well, not making an R-rated Deadpool film, which doesn't surprise. I mean, that's one of those things where it's like, yeah, we're making a Deadpool film. And it's like, okay, can I see some set pics? No, because we're at the... You know, it's like, we're not going to do it.
When they say they're making a film, that's a very different thing to we are currently filming the film.
Yeah.
Changing lanes. Boosh. See, sometimes I have trouble parking, but long straightaways on mostly empty roads, that I've got down. This is taking me right back to all my driving lessons back in England.
Though. Oh, well, you actually did driving lessons.
Yep. Took the test 3 times.
You fucking loser.
Well, apparently it's harder in England.
Oh.
Do you have a license?
Ah, fuck no, I haven't even done a learner's permit.
Well, there you go. Then you go judging me.
Yeah.
It's hard, all this shit.
I mean, I live in the center of Brisbane, and my university's, not far away, and I don't need to drive. Yeah, and cars are expensive. Parking the fuckers are expensive.
Yeah, I live in the city center, and I work from home.
Yeah.
Roll out of bed, start writing.
Just falls to the ground in front of a laptop and lets the genius spill out.
Basically. Yes, thank you.
You're getting tired, Yahtzee.
I understand that, yawning man.
So do you have a selection of yawns that you can choose for your character?
I don't know, I haven't
tried.
Can
you pick a grumbly, sweary trucker?
No, they don't let you choose voice packs, just pictures.
Oh, that's bullshit.
Maybe if I'd picked a female trucker face,
there
would be a more high-pitched yawn, but I'm not sure.
Can you shout obscenities at women drivers?
No, you can just do the dog thing. Hey!
That's not good for your neck.
Not particularly good for driving in a straight lane, either.
Yeah, I mean, the news roundup, because we went to a variety of sites just to see, to see if there was some kind of consensus maybe on a news article that might have had some sort of relevance. Like, I think the one thing that we ran across that could qualify was the PC is sort of outselling consoles as a gaming device.
Well, we all knew that.
Well, I think that's a hard thing to quantify.
Rest stop.
Loads of people buy PCs not exclusively for gaming reasons and then wind up using them for gaming.
Technically, I'm supposed to indicate where I change lanes, but fuck it, you don't get fined.
You are a terrible trucker.
Well, that means I am quite indicative of truckers then, from what I understand from stand-up comedians talk about driving.
Vote UKIP, that's what you gotta do.
UKIP?
Yep.
I don't think anyone calls them UKIP.
Oh, well, I know. I'm not from the UK. Well, I haven't heard someone say it.
I'm at a place for rest game.
You ran over a sign.
Show me the indicator.
Ran over a goddamn sign.
I'm good at that. Where's the bloody sleepy zone?
Wait, it's at E. You're going to have to reverse with a giant trailer full of...
Fucking hell.
That is a very specific rest stop. You don't have hands. They don't show you curling up in your little cab back? Oh,
or,
cool, it's nighttime.
Or murdering prostitutes? No.
Murder.
Gonna put my headlights on.
The lack of hands is a bit weak, I think.
Well, what do you want, man?
Hands. I mean, come on. They finally put feet on FPS characters. They can put hands on truck drivers.
But that might ruin immersion. 356 brought in by driver Ulf. He needs to pull his weight.
Yeah.
I think he is my newest hire.
Shit, the chick brought in like 1,000 or some shit.
Yeah, gotta give him some time to level up.
You got one more chance.
Yeah, you kind of lose the scenery aspect of the game at this point. Now it suddenly turns into In the Mouth of Madness. Just waiting to see a cyclist with his neck on backwards.
I love that. In the Mouth of Madness, there's a little culture point we can discuss. It's, how many... There haven't really been many good Cthulian Mythos kind of films, really.
Well, I'd say In the Mouth of Madness doesn't really capture Lovecraftian horror well either. It's more of a Stephen King's interpretation of Lovecraftian horror.
Yeah, I probably agree with that.
Which is not the same.
I still think it's probably, I don't know, I think it's more Lovecraftian than Stephen King-y than a lot of, you know, Stephen King-y movies. Like, when a movie's quite Stephen King-y,
well, Stephen King is fairly influenced by Lovecraft. He does a lot of the nameless horror in small towns shit.
Let's see, what can I write about? What's immediately outside my window, and what in my office can be haunted?
Yeah, we've made that joke. Right, what do you know? No one buys Stephen King to read. People buy Stephen King to look good on a shelf. Okay, now I'm talking shit to much more popular writers than me, so I should probably stop.
Bring it, Stephen! Yeah! You ain't got nothing on the arts. Fight, fight, fight. I'm gonna get you two in a Twitter fight.
Stop it. So PC's outselling consoles, whoop-de-doo. The main reason for that is that there are a lot of PC gamers who also play consoles, but not much the other way around.
I'm a little curious as to how, because the article didn't seem to have a link as to how that information was come about, and I'm kind of curious as to how you quantify a PC purchase for exclusive gaming. Because you use it, everyone uses the fucking internet at least, like.
I don't know. I'm sure they have their ways.
You'd be surprised how often those ways are just, I made it up.
Well, often they, like, survey 100 people and just assume each person represents 1,000 people.
It's insane how, like, I got a friend that did some stat at uni, and he was just talking about how...
Oh, thanks for overtaking and slowing down, you asshole.
Run into them.
No, because then they'll find me, no matter whose fault it is.
Turn this into Stephen King's duel. Not Stephen King, Steven Spielberg.
Yes.
That wasn't a bad movie, Duel.
I haven't seen it.
It's about a guy who pisses off an insane truck. It's
I know
essentially,
what it's about.
It's essentially like if Jaws was a truck.
Yes, yes.
Because you don't even see the trucker, really. It's just like, it's the so kind it's like, of faceless horror.
So it's like this, but third person.
Yeah, you should run into them. You should rear end them. Oh,
third person camera.
Can see how you're all over the road.
It's actually way harder to steer with that on.
That's horrible.
Satnav says go left, right, rather. I am a slave to Satnav.
I mean, this is something we've been, you know, mulling over an awful lot, and people talking about sort of the Wii U not selling and creating difficulty for Nintendo, but I mean, I don't know. It used to be a thing, like, before USB controllers and a few other little doodads, PC gaming was a niche thing because you had to have a fair degree of, domain-specific knowledge.
Yes, but...
Now any boob can do it.
Now we have the internet.
Well, that and you could, like, fucking trying to plug a controller into a computer, into the fucking printer port, that was, just stuff it in and hope.
Don't make me print it, you.
Yeah, it was so annoying. Like, pre-USB, and particularly pre the fucking 360 controller, just, you can jam a 360 controller into Windows, and it goes, oh, hey, 360 controller. And... it will just work with loads of shit.
But now if you've got a problem running your game, you just go to the Steam forums and someone will say, works fine for me.
Works fine for me.
And then
fucking helpful. That's fantastic.
No more messages.
I'm always confused, like, that was actually that popular tweet of yours, which you stole from me.
No, I didn't.
Yes, you fucking did.
I didn't.
Yeah, that was, I exactly said it's like raising your hand and going, ooh, 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 I don't know.
If anything, I stole it from Blackadder, the first series.
But yeah, that's one thing that I always find perplexing about any form of like online digital communication.
Probably
is people
don't
who
need the big headlights.
No, you totally do. Drive up really close to that guy and turn the big headlights on. See if you can scare him. Scare him.
See if you have your high beams on when you're on just a 2-lane road, the drivers coming the other way will flash angrily at you.
Ah, that's a nice touch.
Because I don't think you're supposed to use them.
No, you're really not. It can be blinding, particularly truck lights.
Yeah.
But yeah, just like forums where people, like, why say I don't know?
People
it seems
who
like
just
want
to be able to say something. I was writing a bit of a ranty article this week on the topic of the phrase "that could be interesting," because it just pisses me off when people say that. It's just trying to occupy space. You're not saying anything. It's like a pre-rendered trailer. It doesn't tell you shit. It's just there to remind you of its existence. Going, hey, this thing still exists. Think about it. Oh, it
could be an interesting article.
Oh, it could be interesting.
I might check that out. It has the potential for interest.
Anything could be interesting. A dead sloth could be interesting.
I generally do find everything sort of interesting, though.
If you set a dead sloth on fire and whirl it around your head and throw it at the queen, that would be a very interesting dead sloth at that point. Oh, shit, I'm critically low on fuel.
Ha!
I hadn't realized.
I don't know. See, I think that's less the sloth that's the interesting part of that arrangement.
Well, it's still the centerpiece.
I mean, I think it adds to it. Like, a dead flaming sloth, more interesting than a dead flaming cat. Because you can have a cat. To have already had a dead sloth is interesting in and of itself.
Well, yes. Even though a sloth, paradoxically, would be much easier to catch and set fire to.
You could probably set fire to it before you even catch it. It would take it a minute before it noticed.
Yeah.
My cousin once dumped a bunch of kerosene on a cane toad in the backyard and set it on fire, and then it just leapt about like this little flame. It was really weird.
See, the thing with Australia is that there is official carte blanche on cane toads.
Yeah, there really is.
All those animal rights people, they will shut up about cane toads.
Because those things are fucking horrid.
Those things are a pest. They ruin everything.
They will eat everything that fits in their mouth. And I mean, like, up to and including mice and rats. If you ever want to see something fucked up, you watch a cane toad try and eat a rat that's only a tiny bit smaller than it. Fucking horrifying.
Go out with a golf club or a blowtorch.
Just... I used to use a sledgehammer. You just run in the backyard and whack them and just try and fucking stop them.
Stick a nozzle up their ass and inflate them with helium.
That's getting creative. I just used to hit them with a big heavy thing.
Watch them float across.
Because you fucking got it. You used to get frogs in this town. Like, just green tree frogs all over the joint. And now it's just fucking cane toads. And these things are just... horrid bloody things.
Yep. That's why Australia is raising a generation of serial killers.
Australia and attempts at natural pest control.
Yes. just get everyone involved. Make it a fun day out for the family. Hand out the golf clubs.
It's kind of disheartening that, you know, we can render things that are otherwise pleasant, harmless, or useful extinct. But when it comes to something that really should be dead, we just can't deal with it.
Well, it was our fault, wasn't it?
Yeah.
The cane toads thing.
Yeah, it was a classic fucking tale of... You know, we had a cane beetle problem, and we were like, well, how about this thing from Hawaii called the cane toad?
It lives
in the cane fields and eats cane beetles. Oh, cool, yeah, put it out here. Turns out it eats everything.
Just to call back to a previous episode, we meddled in God's domain.
Mm.
Although in this case, it really was a bad idea.
Well, it's kind of like rats.
More like meddling in the domain of the natural development of nature and stuff.
Well, the problem is
starlings in America. That I that one.
Yeah.
Well, some asshole wanted to introduce every bird mentioned in Shakespeare to America and introduce starlings, and they became a pest.
It's such a stupid reason to do. That's what I love. That like, let's have all the birds from Shakespeare.
It was a 19th century dude. They were romantic like that.
They're just fucking mental. It's like rabbits and foxes. You know, they're vermin here as well. And you know why they exist here? People wanted to shoot rabbits and foxes. And It's like, can't you just shoot a fucking wallaby? Because that's kind of like halfway between the two.
Yeah, shoot kangaroos. It's a fair. It's actually much more fun, more interesting trophy.
Yeah. Tastier.
So what were
hard
the
to shoot.
So what were the other shitty gaming topics this week? Oh, I remember...
GameSpot closing a bunch of things.
Yes, a whole bunch of GameSpots close. Obsolete thing is obsolete.
Why? I mean, the sad thing is, I don't think you can ever really get rid of physical trading for games.
No, because there's always going to be, the outliers, the people who've just got into it, and the people who aren't that tech savvy.
That and...
Kind of people who don't buy Roombas.
Yeah.
Yeah!
Collectors who like their physical copies, even though a lot of them get it mail order. I don't know, I think it's like because they expanded ridiculously and I think well and truly beyond what was sane, and I think now we're seeing a natural contraction where there'll only be a few video game stores, but they'll have like...
Yeah, they were like...
They'll be more for the collector and the enthusiast.
Like the Game Traders rather than the EB Games. There used to be three EB Games in like a 100-yard radius in Brisbane.
There
City
still
Center.
Is.
There's two.
Oh, did the downstairs one at the...
David Jones, yeah, that one's long gone.
Good, because that was silly. Yeah, three EB Games in a 100-meter radius. Why? Like, what reason could you have for that?
There's still, like, three JB Hi-Fis in the same radius.
They do slightly different shit, though. Like, one JB does mostly, like, furniture and TV stuff, like all the, you know, flat screens and whatnot, and the other one does mostly sort of like content, like DVDs and computers.
Well, they all do video games. And,
well, yeah,
I like
shelves of video games are easy, but those two do have specific sort of...
I like to mix up which one I buy from.
Domains, that's weird.
I mean, I haven't bought from EB in years, because JB always sell cheaper. Don't know why how EB gets away with it.
Yeah. They take a loss on a bunch of stuff in order to get... They make their money, from what I know, on sales of the sort of disc insurance and shit like that.
Yeah, and pre-owned shit.
Yeah, disc insurance and pre-owned stuff.
Because the nasty little crafty thing of pre-owned is that it means they don't have to pay money back to the publisher of the game.
Mm.
Which is an arse. Support your game creators, people.
Yeah, but I mean, when you purchase a physical disc for like the expense that a physical disc comes with, you get the benefit of resale.
Now, if we manage to reverse into that, we get bonus points. But bollocks to that.
Ah, come on, you got to try it.
You only get like 50 XP. I tried it once.
You
don't even get extra cash.
Fucking you, great big
sook.
Yes,
is that the word? Well, let's take another job. Perhaps I can be less of a sook this time. Like we could
I'm not gonna reverse. Take something that might explode.
We're gonna take what's currently in Leon. Oh, a fuel tanker. Going all the way to Duisburg. And good income on that as well. Yeah, I'm bagsy in that.
And we're off on our way to the nether region.
Except now we temporarily don't have a trailer, so...
What was that? Didn't you have to stop on that glowing box?
No.
Yeah.
Because that's not the supplier we're picking up the trailer from.
Oh, right. Okay.
That was the one we were delivering to. There's another supplier around
here. Oh, I see. So you were looking at...
It's just like being a real trucker. And yeah, there's an example of the barrier blocking off the interesting parts of the city.
You're not allowed to go there. That's not for you.
Yes, you made that joke. So another bit of news we found is that the Star Wars people have officially declared the expanded universe is out.
As someone who loves to see fanboys cry, that delights me to no end.
Well, it makes sense to me. They were saying they didn't want to use all those old plot points because they still wanted to surprise. Which makes sense to me.
Then, you know, again, I haven't read them. I have a friend who has, like, indulged in all of the... like expanded Star Wars material, and apparently some of the books can be really fucking good. There's like well written good adventure stories in the Star Wars universe, which I can see as being like that sounds fun. Like that would be fun.
I've heard it varies.
Yeah, but you know, as with anything, it's like the Doctor Who new adventures. Like some of them are just terrible. Some of them are fucking great.
Well, it's the risk you take when you open your series up to fanon, or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, well, it's kind of interesting because there hasn't been. I mean, I'm trying to think of the last time there was this level of a canon modification to a major fan, you know, thing. Because Doctor Who has 50 years of canon and it's all very grey. Like, it is a grey canon series because you can't have anything run for 50 years without basically having to go back on what you said 25 years ago.
Well, that's their luxury because they work with time travel and dimension
and they can change
and stuff.
Yeah, you can just rewrite history.
You can just say, yeah, this is different now because of what the Doctor did in the past.
Yeah, which is, again, you can't... It's like the way a comic book series always, you know, no one's really dead, nothing's really over, because if something lasts for 50 fucking years, you have to just go back on shit. Like, you can't, you know...
Well, Doctor Who always kind of struck me... I haven't watched much of the more recent stuff, but he always struck me as a much more sort of reactive character.
Yeah.
But the stories are all about the people he meets in the new place he's arrived at, and he has no permanence.
It is one of the blessings and one of the curses of the show.
Fuck, it's nearly 6 a.m. All the people are probably driving to work.
So, yeah, like, the entire... You know, just like the entire expanded universe.
Yeah, fuck you, fans.
It was like a million fanboys cried out at once, and then were silenced.
You've been messing around in our play area for too long.
It's sort of interesting, too, because you forget, like, there's a few... You know how Alien Colonial Marines was like, it's in canon, and we both said, who owns and runs the Alien canon?
Yeah, I made that point. I mean, the difference between Star Wars, of course, is that there's a face on it, George Lucas. Star Trek as well, to an extent.
Yeah. Well, Star Trek has keepers of canon.
But Alien was a group effort. It was designed by H.R. Giger. The script was by Dan O'Bannon. It was directed by Ridley Scott. Who owns Aliens? Who is the face of Aliens?
Yeah, because, I mean, after Prometheus, I'd say Ridley Scott can suck a bucket of fucks if he thinks he's going to be in charge of the canon of that series.
Besides, it was only really mega popular as a mainstream franchise after Aliens, which James Cameron directed.
Yeah. That's why I'm looking forward to Avatar 2. Because say what you will about James Cameron, motherfucker does a good sequel.
Yeah, I mean, Avatar 1 was just a load of thinly disguised politics. And CG wank, yes, thank you, with exactly that noise.
It wasn't... I didn't hate... I don't know, like, it was what it was. I wasn't expecting anything but that. Like, you know, I knew it was going to be just a big Dances with Wolves glory masturbation. And
yeah,
like,
I didn't... I don't really like that sort of thing. It's just a white guild wank, isn't it?
Primitive people, they just feel things differently. What I loved was, in this one, though, they actually got to make a planet where... there is an afterlife, where it's like, it's not like just, oh, their spirituality is so nice. It's no, they literally have an ecosystem where they plug their brain in and download into the biosphere.
But how do you know what life is like at that point? It might be a sequence of agonizing horrors, for all you know, where you spend your...
the planet hates you, it's just torment constantly.
Spend your existence being forced down through xylem and phloem you hold for the rest of eternity.
Well, what are you without the restrictions that make you, you know? What's a human without human form? What is consciousness free of the bounds of physicality?
Well, the whatever they were called, the naive in Avatar, well, basically were just humans, were they? But they were humans with pretty big eyes and big innocent faces.
Humans drawn by anime fetishists.
Now, if they did a Last of the Mohicans thing with basically the squid aliens from H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds, that might be interesting. So you got a lone human who, like, falls in love with a squid alien.
Galaxy Quest.
Oh, yeah, there is that. But she did look human.
Galaxy, well, she had a thing that could make it look human, I suppose. So it's just Galaxy Quest is one of my favorite movies. I fucking love that film to death.
It is fun. I remember we were talking about it a while back. We were saying, how do you have Alan Rickman, Sigourney Weaver, and Tim Allen has top billing?
Tim Allen, for a while, I can't remember which year it was, but he had the number one TV show, the number one movie, and the number one book.
Really?
Yeah.
He didn't strike me as a literati type.
You know, it was one of those books that stand-up comedians write, which is sort of just autobiographical with some anecdotes thrown in.
Oh, I see. It was just a wank book.
They're not too bad. I mean, they can be kind of interesting and sometimes funny. I mean, I...
Emphasis on the sometimes.
Yeah, like, I recently, like, a lady friend of mine had Rob Delaney's book and Tina Fey's, and I read them, and they were interesting, and I quite like Tina Fey, so I'm interested in, like, reading about, like, her and her thoughts about sort of, like, comedy writing and stuff like that.
She is one of the few, you know, big-time female comedians, I suppose.
She sets an unrealistic standard of interesting and funny for girls to live up to.
See, I've heard like scientific studies to this that women genuinely have a disadvantage in comedy because people just don't find women as funny as they do men.
I don't get that. Like, there are loads of fucking funny.
Well, it's like a, you know, it's an instinct thing.
Some solid, you know, there's always been good solid female stand-ups, and I think females like have access to a few. Like, there are certain jokes that I can't make because it just doesn't make. Like, I can't make
periods.
Yeah, well, no, well, not just like, you know, it wouldn't make sense coming from me, like, and they, like, I like hearing these perspectives. I like hearing about weird things vaginas do, like the morning after sex, because that's interesting. I don't experience that. You know, I experience going to take a pee and it shooting into my fucking eye. Like, that's, you know, that's a thing I've had to deal with. But I'm curious. You know, I'm curious about these alternate perspectives.
How the hell did you try to take a pee and it shot into your eye? How exactly were you angled at this point?
Well, it wasn't an angle issue. It's a post-sex pee. It can be chaotic.
You're supposed to let it go down first.
Well, no, it wasn't erect. It was like, I'm not getting into the details of it because it's starting to get squidgy.
I'm just not seeing how the wee gets into your eye from down there. If you're trying
I'll
to
explain
point it,
it when you're older.
Unless someone's like taking an axe to your bell end at some point in the past.
Yeah, I was over circumcised as a child. Stop. That's not foreskin.
Moving on from the subject of Gabe's willy.
No, it's a fine penis.
I think this whole Star Wars subject raises the topic of what is canon and does canon really matter?
It's a bit like playing Monopoly. You need a board, you need rules. But at the same time, I don't mind if there's house rules. So like putting the tax money on free parking.
Yes.
I think a too strictly a controlled canon isn't fun and isn't adaptive, but no canon whatsoever is not fun for the other reason, because it's just, you know, you're having to like pick and choose and create your own. And I need the order and structure to be surprised.
Well, yes. Things need to be established.
Yeah.
Things need to be sort of set in stone. That's why when you download a Skyrim mod, they'll often advertise themselves as lore-friendly, as in they fit into the established lore of the game. It's not like, you know, being able to ride a My Little Pony.
Now all the cat people love you and meow.
Oh, petrol.
Oh, petrol. Yep, just do that, Yahtzee. That's fantastic.
Just build a company.
That was great.
You were distracting me with your My Little Pony
talk. Yahtzee Croshaw Trucker.
Well, what do you want? I think I'm doing pretty fucking well for a guy with no
license. My little Yahtzee.
But the thing
is, he's got big eyes.
Shut up. The thing with canon is that someone has to be in control of it, yes?
Yes.
There has to be a control.
There has to be someone you can point to and go that. But again, it's...
But what happens if that person dies or declares he's sick of it and then never wants to do it again?
It gets passed on. Dune got passed on to Frank Herbert's kid, for good or for ill. And again, then I think you're left with like a Sherlock Holmes situation where after long enough, it enters into the public.
Yeah, that's a different thing. That's public domain.
Yeah.
And it sort of ceases to have a canon at that point.
Then they become archetypical. You know, then they become...
It just becomes that thing.
And I think the canon then enforces itself sort of subconsciously. I think once a character is that deeply ingrained in the culture, I think a degree of their canon is so well established that things like BBC's Sherlock series, for instance, even though it goes against it, it functions because we're aware of the it that it's going against. You know what I mean? Like, it's... It works because we're aware of the core from which it deviates. Like, that gives it its value comes from
bollocks.
That. Fucking, can you not kill people? Or was that just from the last, like, multiple fucking car tragedy you caused?
I think someone nudged my trailer. My trailer of fuel.
That is, that, like, even I know not to do that. That is car 101. Hey, look, fuel. I just cut across, like, three lanes.
Oh, listen to fucking Jeremy Clarkson over here. This isn't as easy as it looks.
I'd love to do that, like, small car thing just because I'd get a license exclusively for it and make that the first time I've ever driven a car, like, properly by myself, just, like, me tearing around the track.
Okay.
Or just lie and say I have a license and do it anyway. Do you have to have a license if you're driving just around a track like that?
I don't know.
I'm kind of curious now. I'm kind of ask, I want to race. Do you have a license? No. The car's got a roll cage. Like, what's the worst that can fucking happen? I've seen people on Top Gear roll that fucker. They seemed okay.
I don't know what the rule is. Maybe you can drive on private property without a license. Maybe it's that.
I know, like, there are strange rules for the country. Like, 14-year-olds can have licenses to drive tractors and shit.
Well, that would suit a much more predominantly rural community with the large families who have to work the farms, wouldn't it?
Rural.
Yes, that was the word I said.
Rural.
Rural.
Rural. The rural juror.
Let's not obsess over the pronunciation of the word rural.
It's just reminding me of a 30 Rock joke.
Okay, I haven't watched much 30 Rock.
You should, it's fun. Okay, here we go. We'll get to Culture Corner again. Yahtzee didn't watch anything this week because he's a giant twat.
Couldn't be asked.
It's watching a fucking movie, dude, or at least a TV show.
Trying to find a game to review for next week.
Yeah.
It's absolutely fuck all. I've downloaded a load of indie stuff on Steam and it's all just bores me to tears.
It is kind of sad that, like, the indie genre is now...
I mean, there's shit, interesting shit coming out on Monday, but I got a review to write on Monday.
What comes out Monday?
I think Amazing Spider-Man 2, the game, and also this thing called Daylight that has caught my eye.
Oh, what is that? That sounds
familiar.
It's
a horror roguelike.
Yeah.
I think it's roguelike. I know it's horror. But it sounded intriguing, and I'm going to check it out.
I don't like procedurally generated stuff too much.
You're wrong to dislike that.
No, it fucks up my ability to feel like I've explored the whole thing.
Well, if you've seen all the variants, then you've seen the whole thing.
Yeah, I'm exploring to be solid. If it's constantly changing, I just get annoyed.
I love roguelike games.
I'm not saying they're objectively bad. I explain my reason. It's because of that.
I'm very fond of FTL. I'm very fond of Rogue Legacy. And lest we forget, I'm currently working. Oh bollocks! Lest we forget, I'm currently working on a roguelike game called The Consuming Shadow. I should probably do some sprites for. But I
was going to say, is this another one of those circumstances where you worked really hard on it for a while and then now you've not touched it in like a month?
I am trying to get some sprites done, but that's always the most arduous thing for me. It is in a constant state of development, I assure you.
perpetual beta.
But it's just finding the time in between zero punctuation, writing my novel, writing my column, writing poetry.
Run out the back of a car.
And not being completely fucking exhausted after all of that. And also playing video games.
And also trying to enjoy the hobby to which you've dedicated yourself so earnestly.
Enjoy.
I know. I find that kind of funny. Like you just
see, this is where I'm at now. This is what I'm doing for to unwind in the evening. I'm playing Euro Truck Simulator and listening to podcasts.
Fucking depressing. So I watched Snowpiercer.
Did you?
Yeah.
I've never heard of that.
It's based on it's like kind of dystopian future, and I have a massive fucking hard on for dystopian future. So
I know you do.
I was like, this is a 2013 movie called Snowpiercer. I was like, oh, that sounds cool.
I bet you're one of those twats who thinks to themselves, I'm really looking forward to the apocalypse. I bet I'd do really well.
No, I like indoor plumbing. I like garbage pickup. I like the things of society. That's why I say you don't like first world nations. Dingbats in functional democracies shouldn't be bitching about, like, fucking revolution because, you know, poo goes away to your house and water comes to it. I don't want that system to stop.
Appreciate your poo pipes, ladies and gentlemen.
Like, that was what allowed Rome to conquer so many places because they'd show up, go, toilets! And then leave. And everyone would be like, oh, that's pretty nifty.
Probably shouldn't have used lead in the pipes, though.
Well, our hindsight, bad. You know. That's...
Our bad history of civilization.
Why am I angry and horny all the time? That's what it does, priapism. Lead poisoning gives you just a raging boner pretty much all the time.
And why is the emperor a giggling man-child?
I've been reading more Roman history lately for some of my courses, and Claudius wrestled an orca.
I didn't hear he wrestled. I heard he killed it with spears.
Oh, see, the thing I read was in Sicana, and he said, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, he said that the term was wrestled an orca, so I don't know, maybe wrestled with spears. But it didn't kill him. That was what was interesting. Like, you know, how often can someone fight an orca and live?
Claudius is an interesting story.
Yeah.
He was...
I just read the pumpkinification of Claudius.
Basically, in his early life, no one took him seriously.
Well, he had probably some kind of palsy or something.
He was deaf and disabled and...
ugly. And things like that back then
He tended to study a lot, but he was perceived as being weak. And then while Caligula was emperor, he escaped the purges of his family just because no one took him seriously. Caligula just kept him around to bully him, basically.
It's the sneaky fucker. Like, if nobody thinks about you...
Well, Claudius wasn't involved in the plot to kill Caligula.
No.
I mean, they killed Caligula, and then the Praetorian Guard found Claudius allegedly hiding behind a curtain, and then said, hey, we're just going to make you emperor now. And he served as emperor up to his death for, like, quite a few years, and did a really good job.
Well, it's not a bad job.
There are mixed reports on history. Not as bad as fucking Caligula or Nero, who came after him.
No, that's the funny thing, too, because everyone was real excited for Nero, because everyone thought he was going to be better than Claudius, and, well, that took a turn for the worst.
You know, everyone thinks that their current leader is the worst they've ever had. That's just, you know, democracy for you.
Well, I mean, back in Roman days, back in the Empire,
So this is the guy responsible for everything that's still shit.
Yeah.
Thanks, Obama.
That's pretty much how Queensland works. Like, Queensland doesn't have an upper house, and we essentially, every 20 years, just elect the other lot for another 20-year bracket. It's fascinating to watch.
Basically,
you can't win government in Queensland, you just have to lose it, and that just, it takes 20 years.
The trouble with the opposition in Australia now is they just agree with everything the government does.
I don't know.
I mean, get this, Tony Abbott just bought 12 fighter planes we didn't need. So that he can continue fighting pointless
wars
for
other people. Who's attacking Australia, really?
So he can continue fighting pointless wars for other people, and for the sake of big business. And Labour, the opposition, just went, yep, good idea.
Yeah.
I mean, at the same time...
Piss-weak opposition.
They're cutting all the like public services at the same time.
Trying to add a copay for doctor's visits.
It's really fucking annoying.
There's always... Australia's been involved in every major foreign conflict since the Boer War and been attacked once by the Japanese. Not once, like, there were a few attacks, but, like, you know, in terms of the one, you know, wartime engagement.
Even if the Japanese invaded, the actual policy of Australia was fuck it.
Yeah, the Brisbane line.
They said as long as they stay north of Brisbane, which is basically the centre point of Australia, they can have it.
The plan was abandon it back to Brisbane. If the Japanese got a foothold in Cairns, we just went, fuck it, and piss bolted.
Yeah,
and
left them. Good luck occupying that.
Shitloads of Australia to occupy, which as white people had to discover slowly, is not an easy fucking task. It's not a nice country.
No, there's a lot of shit you can't do anything with.
The Aborigines survived here, you know, by adapting incredibly well to a really hostile environment. Like the Brisbane line, it was just like bail. You can have the lot up to Brisbane and figure out if you could figure out how to work with it better than, you know, kudos to you.
Yeah, good luck.
My great granddad had a map actually.
It's like trying to conduct a land war in Siberia.
Yeah, this Australia is just hot Siberia, most of it.
Yeah. Except we haven't really had the examples of history that Siberia has. Siberia's been invaded again and again and again, single time. The invaders have gotten cold and lost.
Just like, you know, kind of like Afghanistan. It's like,
but Australia's never been invaded except by white people.
Good old whitey.
I've forgotten how we got onto this.
I don't know. It's kind of funny, though. Like, my great-granddad had a map of Australia drawn up by the Japanese. It had Australia divided into prefectures, and they had shit in the middle. Like, they had prefectures for, like, the middle of Australia. And I want you to open Google Earth now and look at Australia. Really fucking look at it. And, like, have a look at it in relation to, like, Britain and Japan, chunks of the states. Like, there's stuff in the middle of America. There's nothing in the middle of Australia. I want to stress the nothing.
Well, there's Alice Springs.
I'm actually really keen. You know, I'm going to volunteer to do, like, teaching work out there. I want to see it. I'm curious. Like, I'm fascinated by it.
I've considered taking a tilt train journey across the country.
Oh, we should do that. We should do it as buddies.
Oh, that would be so cute.
Tilt train tour of Australia. Because it's don't get me wrong, it's beautiful. Like, it's a terrifyingly gorgeous nothing.
It's only beautiful as long as you're just passing by through the window.
As long as you have water.
Yeah.
So as long as you are near.
As long as you're in a nice tilt train with some nice leg room and
you
some
have,
refreshments.
You have, like, a good battery-powered GPS locator of some description. That lets someone find you
and go, look at the humbling awesome might of nature out there, glad we're not in it.
There's some weird stuff in the Australian outback too. You know, there's a desert frog, and it's think about a frog and then what you traditionally understand a frog, and then understand that there's one that lives in the fucking desert, and it does this by secreting a mucus membrane that creates a sac around it that functions like a fucking amniotic sac, and then it buries itself and can remain buried for decades until every now and again it just piss rains out in the outback and lake air fills up and it becomes like one of the largest inland seas in the world. Air's rock, because the pigmentation of it is actually reflective, turns blue, which you can find pictures of. It's really interesting. And for a brief moment, the outback is alive, everything wakes up, has sex, and then buries itself again for the next, like, 20 fucking years. It's a bizarre ecosystem.
Ayers Rock, sometimes known as the lobster of natural formations.
Uluru, to use the native tongue.
Oh, yes. You can tell because of all the ooze in it.
Mm. Aboriginal dialects are interesting. Like, I've been reading stuff about, like, languages for my, because I'm doing English, so I'm kind of interested in language now.
Yes.
And there's, I can't remember the name of it because some Aboriginal words are really hard to remember, but there's a dialect of a group, I think a bit north of Alice Springs, that even the other Aboriginals said was a fucking bizarre dialect and hard to learn. And like lingually it was mental, like it just...
So like Eskimos, they had 20 different words for punishing sand you can't grow shit.
Well, it's not even that, like just the syntax and the structure was weird, like... There's a good book called In the Land of Invented Languages, which is a fun read and also gives you a good grounding in the ways language can really be different. Like, it's because you don't think about it until you sort of, you know, read about it. It's a real easy, like, language is a real easy thing to not know about because it's innate. You just get used to yours. But
bollocks.
Oh, you're good at this. They sort of learned English, and so they integrated English into this weird dialect, and now it's even stranger. And there's been a few Aboriginal languages that have died, and I think one of the... I can't remember his name either, because, again, some of these names are hard to remember, but there was one dude left who spoke this particular Aboriginal dialect, and linguists were like, here, tell us all of it, and we'll write it down, and that way it won't die. And in such beautiful Aboriginal fashion, he was just like, nope, some things just end. just refused. Then the language just died. And that's happened a couple of times, actually.
Well, he's got a point. I mean, I hear a lot of efforts of... People trying to save languages. Like someone was trying to save the Cornish language back in England.
I didn't even know the Cornish had their own language.
Well, they don't. They all speak English.
Yeah. I didn't even know it existed. It's an interesting thing.
But considering that language is supposed to be a tool to aid communication between people, is there much point of keeping one that only one person speaks?
Well, I mean, I think at this point, maintaining it as an objective interest of study, like just so you can say, look, there it is. Like, I think that's a good habit that humans have, you know, well, this desire to preserve.
I guess people still study Latin. Although some people question the point of that as well.
Well, I mean, given how much of modern English is structured off of Latin, I think it can be valuable.
Well, all the Latin languages as well.
Yeah.
Just that Latin has some really fucking crazy rules.
Some of those rules have carried over to English, like the never end a sentence with a preposition thing, which is just bullshit. Like, that's dumb.
You have to watch the Romani's Ite Domum scene from Life of Brian to see how complex the language gets. People called Romani, they go the house. Monty Python quotes.
Life of Brian's their best movie.
I agree.
In the strangest way possible?
I don't know. I put it alongside Holy Grail, but Holy Grail has kind of been ruined by the fans.
A kidney stone? Like, yeah, I it's not to say I don't like Holy Grail. Holy Grail's still more of a sketch film. Yes. And I think Life of Brian, A, holds together better as a single film. B is cripplingly fucking funny. Like, just.
And it manages to be a sketch film as well.
It manages like a degree of sketch film that I think ties to the basic plot line better and is a brilliant comment on sort of the nature of religion. Like, yes. I remember the other, like, there was a great time of seeing Michael Palin actually angry when he was arguing with a bishop about the Sermon on the Mount scene. And they said that they were making fun of the Sermon on the Mount. And he's like, that's not what we're doing, you fucking idiot. We're making fun of the natural human propensity to mishear things. And just the comedy that, you know, arrives from people standing at the very edge of the Sermon on the Mount and just not getting it.
That's quite ironic, really, isn't
it? That's the cheese makers. Oh,
it's quite ironic. Someone complaining about mishearing that scene.
Yeah, that was a good laugh.
You can see why he might have gotten exasperated.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's a good documentary about it and the whole hullabaloo that went on about Life of Brian.
Hullabaloo. I think we just passed over the French-Netherlands border.
We are now in the Nether region.
Well, I'm not sure why, because we're supposed to be going to Germany.
Yeah. I thought you were you?
Oh. I just had paid off some of my loan. Oh, actually, we're in, by the looks of it, we're near Luxembourg.
He has a wife, you know. Yes. I still laugh at that. I'll watch that, like, once a
Monty
week.
Python quotes.
No, but I was enjoying the discussion about it.
That's one of my favourite scenes in Life of Brian, where the soldiers are trying not to laugh at Pontius Pilate's speech.
Because apparently they weren't told what was going to happen. The only instruction they were given is for this scene you were not allowed to laugh.
Yes, I know that because I told you.
Was it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you can...
Whatever
Michael Palin does, you've got to keep a straight face and not laugh.
When Pontius realizes what's going on, it just starts looking around, and then just, he has a wife, you know. Like, that line always gets me, because it's just...
And you want to feel like a little giggle. How about you? Do you find it visible?
So good. Another bit that fucking always kills me is the whole space battle ending with that guy just going, oh, you lucky bastard.
I think that might have been the most Gilliam-esque scene in
That was definitely Gilliam's contribution. Dad told me he laughed so hard in the cinema at that he nearly shat himself.
Okay. It was just... People traditionally piss themselves laughing, but
well, he said he made the mistake of, like, going in, like, you know when you kind of have to take a dump, but you think, oh, I'll skip it, and then it just becomes a real issue in, like, 20 minutes? By that stage, you didn't want to leave the film.
I'm in Luxembourg, and I'm not sure why. Sat-nav just made me go here.
I'm pretty sure that was... Because that was the thing. I made the Nether region joke earlier because you were going to the Netherlands. Like, is it the Netherlands, or is it Netherlands?
It's the Netherlands, which incorporates Holland and a couple of other things.
Oh, right. Oh, okay, so it's a name for a region, not a singular country.
It's a bit confusing that, like, Europe generally is. Like how Czechoslovakia is now the Czech Republic and Slovakia.
And Bosnia and Herzegovina.
Yeah, and all that business with Yugoslavia.
I had a tutor who was from the, you know, the region known as Yugoslavia, formerly known as Yugoslavia, and it's kind of, she had this really interesting perspectives on it, because it shouldn't have worked, because it was like some guy just decided to get four different ethnicities, four different religions, and a couple of different languages, and like try to jam them together and make them one country.
Well, the United Kingdom managed it.
Well, that's the thing. He managed it for as long as he was alive, and then once he died, it just sort of collapsed in on itself.
Oh, well, that's the problem with the dictatorship, isn't it?
Yeah. The weird thing is now, digital Yugoslavias have sprung up. So there's like these
Is that like Second Life?
Yeah, sort of. Because people sort of pine for the old... Like, there are groups of people who sort of pine, I kind of miss Yugoslavia. That was nice, wasn't it? And so there's these funny little digital Yugoslavias that have cropped up.
See, the trouble with the... integrating everything into the global nation is that you need to have an enemy. People cannot function without something to blame, and if you can't put that in the form of a foreigner, they will blame you.
I think they can. I think it takes effort to get people out of that habit.
I think people, because of the natural instinct to protect the family and fear the outsider that has been with us since the very beginnings of our evolution, that is why humans will never live in peace.
Well, yeah, but humans are also capable of rational thought. And if you encourage,
that.
Yes, well, they're capable.
I'm gonna paraphrase Men in Black. A human is capable of rational thought. Human beings are panicky and fearful and dangerous, and you know it.
At the moment, yes. I don't think it's valuable to consider that an unchangeable circumstance.
Who was it who said the IQ of a crowd is the IQ of its stupidest member divided by the number of people in the crowd?
I don't know, but that's a good line. But again, I think that problem can be fixed, because if the crowd then, you know, if the stupidest member of the crowd is still pretty smart, then, you know, that's improving the circumstance. Like, I believe that is a condition that can be changed through work, education, and leadership.
So would you say you'd rather be in the Templar Order or the Assassins?
Nobody. I don't like joining groups.
Well, let me explain my position. Let's explain that question. The Assassins were all about total freedom and... eventual anarchic peace.
Well, see, everything...
The Templars are all about total peace through total control.
Everything has caveats. Sometimes you need control, sometimes you need a bit of anarchy. And the thing is, everyone looks for those objective structures where they can just say it was the right thing to do, when really all you can do is act and take responsibility for your decision. Like, you can explain why you made your decision and then just take responsibility for it.
I think both positions are kind of... stupid.
Well, no one thing to an extreme.
You could say, hey, it's total anarchy, there's no rules now, and then someone someone strong oppresses the weak. What do you do then?
Well, that's the thing. Rules are an emergent factor of social organization. Like, they're, you know, we're a social species, rules emerge.
Just press my don't yawn, an exciting storm is happening.
Excitement.
Look at those windmills.
Windmills do not work that way. Good night.
Sorry, wind turbines, not windmills. Windmills are specifically the things that make grain.
Yeah, that used to crush up grain so you can have a loaf of bread.
That's what the mill part means.
It's funny, there's a windmill in Brisbane, and it's called a windmill, even though it wasn't a windmill, it was actually a slave mill. it's where convicts got tied to a thing and were made to walk around in a circle, like the beginning of Conan.
Australia, the country without shame. It's like the man without fear.
Yeah...
Stolen Generation. I don't need to apologize for that. Fuck you.
Oh, the nation finally. The nation did eventually.
That was an official governmental position.
Oh yeah, well that was you know, that was our right wing government, where it's just like, fuck you.
How much has changed?
The Liberal Party. We just fucking straight up hate abos. Oh, I don't like them.
Yeah, bunch of assholes getting all drunk on the alcohol we introduced.
I was going to say something, but I thought that wouldn't be as fun.
Bollocks.
Probably just killed a child.
Don't care, I'm a trucker.
I wonder if there are any truckers that listen to this while they drive. You suppose it's like gone from CB radio chats to like, you know, maybe Wi-Fi, internet, and people listening to podcasts as they drive?
I don't know. I'd listen to podcasts.
So you'd listen to podcasts while you drive your truck?
I don't know, truckers strike me as a traditionalist sort.
What would you name your truck? Because the truck's got to have a name. Betty? Cool. What would you have painted on the side? Would it be a chick, or would it be like a sexy PS4?
I would just paint atrocious satanic doodles with the blood of a prostitute.
So, you know, a traditionalist then.
I did decide on the color scheme for this truck.
And you went with safety orange.
With a blue stripe. A blue racing stripe.
Makes it go faster.
Hey, a rest stop, and I'm knackered. And we should probably wrap this video up.
How long have we been talking?
1 hour and 9 minutes. So let's...
getting some extra. A little extra talk.
Let's pop in here and have a little kip, and that will be a natural conclusion.
So it was a slow news week.
And we talked about a whole bunch of bollocks.
Yeah.
You're welcome, Internet.
Yeah. Here you go. There's your fucking entertainment for the week, you slathering horde of...
Another hour of people talking bollocks has been added to the internet, because there was such a shortage of that. Anyway, sweet dreams, truck murderer man. Bye-bye, everybody.
Toodle pip.